Welcome to ArizonaSportsCast.com's Daily Fix. I am Ralph Amsden, and it is already the second Friday in January. January 11th, 2019. Where is the time going? This is crazy. I better start talking about some sports before I have to turn around and put Christmas decorations back up. Let's get to it.
They tell me that no man is an island, but it feels like it's a storm that I've been fighting. And I used to listen to the radio, but I've got an army of voices in my head. Voices in my head. We used to live in stereo, but I've got an army of voices in my head. Voices in my head.
I hope everybody's had a good week. I know I have. This has been a really, really cool venture for me to launch this website, something I've been thinking about doing for a really long time, this daily podcast. Some of the other podcasts that are in the works are getting finalized today. Just released the artwork for the podcast that's going to cover Arizona State football and basketball. It's called The Devil Train, and I worked with an artist on the podcast art, had a lot of fun with that, getting ready to launch that soon. I'm absolutely living my dream of, you know, it's been a little bit interesting. This is the week, you know, if you got kids where, you know, your kids, they go back to school after like a two and a half week break. You know, we don't let our kids like stay up till 3 a.m. and sleep till noon or anything like that, but just to watch them get back into the routine of, you know, just getting up at 6:30 and packing their backpack, brushing their teeth, making their breakfast, making their lunch, helping each other out, not bumping into each other and knocking each other down the stairs. Watching them try to get back into that has been hilarious. And, you know, for them, it's been a little bit brutal. I'm pretty sure I have four kids, a 10, a 9-year-old, a kindergartner, and one who goes to daycare, a 3-year-old who goes to daycare a couple of days a week. And it's been a rough time for them. The older two have been late for school every single day this week, so I'm looking forward to that phone call from their teachers. But, you know, this has been me starting a new routine as well, recording these daily podcasts for you and planning, you know, what it's going to look like in the future. And I just got to say, man, I could not be more appreciative of the people that have texted and emailed and called me and left comments on YouTube or on Podbean or on SoundCloud. Still working on getting this uploaded to iTunes for you guys. I am at their mercy, waiting for them to approve me. I changed the name of the podcast, and so they made me go through the approval process all over again. I am hoping to go ahead and get that taken care of for all of you who like to just, you know, open up your latest podcasts on your iPhone and go through it that way. That's the way I do it. I listen to about 10 different podcasts, and I like to just open it up to the latest episode of whatever it is and let it play through. Hopefully, I'll be able to do that for you guys soon. I'm just waiting on Apple to go ahead and get me approved. But in the meantime, I appreciate everyone who's listened and reached out, and I'm looking forward to making this something that is entertaining for you guys, helps you pass the time, helps make your week a little bit better. And just for anybody who listens to this, I mean, you don't have to. So I appreciate you spending your time listening to me rant and rave about various things and keep you up to date on different Arizona sports topics. And there are always Arizona sports topics to talk about. I want to start with something that's a little bit different. I think that for those of you that know me, or have heard of me or followed what I've done, a lot of what I do is cover high school sports. I will never not cover high school sports. There's something about it that is a little bit more innocent. There's something about it that's it's just a little bit more concentrate of those things that you really, really enjoy about sports, about live sports, about people who really care about, you know, life lessons, all of that. I love being close to it. I love just seeing, you know, my favorite thing in the entire world is to watch somebody fail on the football field at the high school level, you know, drop a pass on 3rd and 10 that would have got them the first down. Watch watch them run to the sideline, you know, sit down on the bench, hang their head, and have four teammates walk up to them and say, "Hey, keep your head up. You got the next one." Like, I love that stuff. That's the beginning of something that's going to last them for the rest of their life, either being on the receiving or giving end of that, just being tethered together and making sure that, you know, everybody's able to sort of keep on and move forward. I'm a huge fan of high school sports, and so I wanted to start off today's show in a little bit different of a direction. I'm going to talk a little bit about high school sports. I'm not going to do it very often on the Daily Fix, but I did write something tonight that I want to share with you, the listener. And just kind of, you know, I would love to get your comments on this because it's going to come out tomorrow, I think, on sports360az.com. If not there, arizonavarsity.com. Whoever wants to run it gets to run it. But I wrote a proposal last night, a column that basically says we should not have playoffs anymore in high school football. And on its surface, that might sound completely crazy, but you know, the way that Arizona high school sports works is you got your three or four dominant teams, kind of similar to college, right? You got your Alabamas, you got your Clemsons, going to be in the playoff every single year. And then the people that are right on the outskirts, like Georgia and things like that. ASU and U of A are on the come up, right? Yeah, they're right behind those teams. But, you know, you've got your teams that make the playoff every single year and just blow everybody else out. Well, that's how Arizona high school football works. Saguaro High School's won six titles in a row. Centennial, I think, has at least been in the title game almost every single year that I've covered high school football in the state of Arizona. Chandler High has won four of the last five championships at the highest level. And before that, I think, you know, Hamilton was in like the championship 9 of 10 years and won 7 of them or something crazy like that. You definitely have your haves and your have-nots, right? Well, you know who's going to be in the championship and who's probably going to win the championship before the season even starts. It's obvious. And the way that the Arizona Interscholastic Association is exploring changing this or providing some type of remedy is to have an open division playoff. Take the best 8 teams in the state, regardless of division, at the end of the season and throw them into a playoff so that other people have a chance to win their different brackets and regions and playoff tournaments and things like that. So this year you'd have Chandler and Centennial and Saguaro all in one playoff bracket, and only one could win what would essentially be a super division state championship. That's a proposal that is probably going to get approved here in a couple of weeks. I think the AIA has a meeting on January 22nd. So I put out this last-ditch proposal, right? I wrote it up basically as a plea to them to say, don't do this. Don't go down this road. I mean, you can go down this road, but instead consider this other thing. I think the state of Arizona should get rid of playoffs completely. No more playoffs. As it stands right now, there's 6 divisions. One is 8-man football, which I don't totally understand. And then the rest are 11-man football, but based on the enrollment of the high school. At the end of the year, they take the top 16 teams. They all, you know, battle it out. And the team that you figured would probably win ends up winning. I say get rid of it. I say it's time to move to a bowl system. I mean, think about it. As a kid, I would look at college football and think like, oh, why don't they have a playoff? Why don't they have the playoff? But I'm bought in at this point. I mean, I like the end of season play. I like the 4-team playoff. That's pretty cool. You know, they could expand it to 8, and I wouldn't really care. And it'd be interesting to see the 5 conference champions all have a chance to get in with 3 at large. I think that would make for some really interesting conversation. And at the very least, the Pac-12 could maybe get a representative every once in a while. But as it stands, I absolutely love that every week matters, that every game matters, that every season is memorable for whether or not you qualify for a bowl, and if you win that bowl, where you get to travel to, who performed well in that bowl. I'm obsessed with it. I think it's fantastic. As it stands right now, Arizona high school football teams play 10 games. I say make them play 11 and then let them play in a bowl game. And then if you absolutely have to, make it a standard that you can only qualify for this 8-team super division playoff at the end of the year. If you win your bowl, then you use some type of points or measurement system to take the top 8 teams and let them play their little playoff after everybody gets to play a bowl game. And it might sound silly and it might sound radical, but the truth is the people who pay attention to high school football in the state of Arizona, they just are consistently nagging about the same stuff over and over again, that the vast majority of above average teams have zero chance to win a championship, that there is embarrassingly low turnout for opening round and quarterfinal playoff games because the ticket prices are higher than they are in the season. You can't use your student pass, and you know, you're getting taxed for your success. The more you win, the more playoff tickets you have to buy. And if you know that you're going to get worked by 40 points, it's great weather in November. You might as well go do something else. The other thing is a lot of kids transfer in order to be part of championship teams. I used to think that that wasn't true, but I see it more and more every single year. Teams with winning records sometimes miss out on the postseason because their strength of schedule wasn't all that great, but maybe a 3-7 team will get into the playoffs because they play in a region with a bunch of teams that blew them out by 60, but because those teams were tough, their strength of schedule is good enough to get in. That's a dumb thing that happens every single year. And then a lot of the teams in Southern Arizona and in the White Mountains and on reservations and in rural communities all feel really disconnected. They feel like their playoffs happen over in a corner while the big schools get to play in big stadiums, which is a true thing that happens. And so, you know, there's all these old crotchety guys, and I'm well on my way to becoming an old crotchety guy, that are part of the ether of any high school football community in any state, right? It's a bunch of guys who used to play. They have their idea of the way that they want to do things. And a lot of these guys that are sort of the ruling class of Arizona high school football or high school football in any state, they look at young kids and they are just disgusted with the way that this generation is, the way they're coming up, the way that Gen Xers sort of, you know, everyone gets a trophy type culture. But I personally feel like you can take advantage of the different weird ways, weird in the eyes of you know, our greatest generation or our boomers, weird in the eyes of them. But the truth is, you know, things are the way they are, and you got to find a way to roll with it. So, you know, there are certain things that you can do to take what this generation of kids responds to and still reinforce your own values and come up with a really good system. And I think the system already exists in college football. And I think that high school football, it would be awesome to have bowls. It would change so much about, you know, the landscape of the way things are and how things get done. You know, it's time for the people that have the ability to influence the policies and procedures of high school athletics to stop using their power to fight the tide and shake their fist at the youth and start using the influence that they have to ride the wave of change into like a mutually beneficial set of circumstances, right? If you don't like that these kids come up in a world where everyone gets a trophy, but you also don't like that the few trophies that you hand out might as well have the school's names permanently engraved on them, the answer is more trophies, but ones that actually get earned through a team's success in a bowl game. If these, you know, if the older generation doesn't like that teams participate in postseason games in front of half-empty stands, make the postseason game that they play in count for something. You know, and one of the things that I absolutely hate about high school football is these great coaches who are invested in kids and do it for such, you know, pocket change. They get ground down by the process. The guys that could really have a great positive impact on youth last maybe 3 or 4 years before they're completely burned out. So if you don't like that the pressure to win a rigged game keeps forcing good men from the coaching ranks in hopes that a school will, you know, stumble on a magic formula for winning if they take a ride on the offseason coaching carousel, which Cardinals fans, ASU fans, U of A fans should all be very familiar with, give the coaches more measurable achievements with which to celebrate. Give them the pride of qualifying for or coaching in or potentially winning a bowl game. I think it'd be cool. I think it'd be really cool. I think that you could take those rural teams that feel neglected, and you could put them on a main stage, have them play in a neutral site stadium right in the Phoenix area and make a big deal of it. Make them feel included. You could use bowl games to do that. Why not? All you'd have to do is just say that, you know, any make it an 11-game season. Say that participants have to have 6 wins and no major, like, recruiting or bye rule violations. Say that you couldn't have played each other in the regular season. That way it makes it a unique matchup. It has to be at a neutral high school. You could slot the bowls like college football does, with like one region's winner against another, or a number 4 big region team against a number 2 smaller region team. But I don't like that. If it was up to me, I would say ignore the divisions completely. And just when it comes to the bowl matchups, use like an overall state ranking formula. So maybe a Division 4 team plays a Division 6 team. But if they're similarly ranked in that formula, maybe they should play each other. Maybe they should play each other. You maybe allow the school's ADs the ability to approve the matchups, and they get one veto. So if there's a school they really don't want to play, or it's too far to travel or whatever, they can veto it once, but they can't veto a second time, because if you veto a second time, you don't get to play in a bowl. And then if you really, really want that open division playoff, then, you could have multiple open division playoffs divided amongst the smaller and the larger schools. You could still have them, but you have to make that open division playoff appearance contingent on whether you won a bowl, then take the top 4 or 8 teams that qualify and have them play it out for the old fashioned state championship. But you don't need to do that. You could just go with bowls. So my whole thing is, maybe the proposal sounds radical, but to me, nothing is as radical as upholding the status quo while the same, well-known issues that people complain about corrode and corrupt the whole student-athlete experience. That experience deserves to be free from the ever-present whining and groaning and gnashing of teeth about the way that things should be. The bowl games work in college football. I say that we give them a try in high school football. I think it'd be fun. And that's the end of my rant on that. Let's move on to the big boy stuff, right? Sean McVay. How many times as a Cardinals fan have you heard that name over the last few days? I'm about sick of it, which led me to make an ill-advised tweet. Every tweet is ill-advised. Herm Edwards was right. Don't push send. Delete your account. Never tweet. All of those things. But I'm confused. I'm confused. And I understand what the Cardinals were trying to do. I absolutely get it. I get why they hired Kliff Kingsbury. They have a young quarterback. They have some impressive pieces on offense in David Johnson and Christian Kirk. You want somebody who's innovative to come in and turn things around. And in 2016... Jared Goff started 7 games. He went 0-7. He got sacked 26 times. And they bring in Sean McVay, young Sean McVay, the offensive coordinator from Washington, D.C. And, they let him get going. And all of a sudden, Jared Goff, his sophomore season, only gets sacked 25 times. One less time than the 7-game season, abridged season he played the year before. Which is great. I mean, Sean McVay is a guy who had NFL experience. He was a coordinator. He was the best man for the job. And there was a couple of other things about that hire that people aren't pointing out, or I feel like they're not pointing out. I personally feel like it's not all Sean McVay. I think that success is multifactorial, okay? And you have to look at some of the things about Sean McVay. And it's weird to me that he's the golden standard and he's what everybody wants to copy. Because, yes, he has 24 wins in 2 years, which is incredible, right? 24 wins in 2 years of a team that lost its last 7 before he took over. He doesn't have a playoff win yet. I mean, he might get one this weekend. We'll see. But he doesn't have a playoff win yet. 10 of his 24 wins in the last 2 years are against the NFC West. The NFC West is terrible. It includes the Arizona Cardinals, who had the worst offense in the league and probably the worst offense in franchise history. And the team that had the worst offense in the league and the worst offense in franchise history beat one of the other teams in the division twice. I think the Cardinals and 49ers were like 7-25 combined. Of course the Rams went 6-0 against them, the NFC West this year. There's no more Legion of Boom in Seattle. And it just so happens that this prodigy coach also has a prodigy quarterback who's a number one pick. And a front office that absolutely goes hard in the paint. This is what I tweeted. They have a prodigy at quarterback and a front office that goes hard in the paint. I believe that no front office has done more to set their franchise quarterback up for success than the Rams. Than the way that they've drafted, in the way that they've made trades, in the way that they've made sure that there's defensive linemen all over the league that are on the Rams' defensive line instead of anybody else's chasing down Jared Goff. I think that the Rams have done a fantastic job from top to bottom, and I think that Sean McVay is an integral part of that success, but he's just a part. So my confusion comes in when the entire league decides that they so badly want to copy what the Rams are doing that they ignore what the Rams did and just try to replicate that small part of the result. And I get that it's a copycat league. I get that. But I also think to myself that if we're going to hold somebody up as the gold standard in the NFL, maybe that guy's Doug Peterson. He's 5-0 in the playoffs with a backup quarterback the entire time. Maybe they should be out looking for the next Doug Peterson. I'm saying I'm personally fascinated with the idea that general managers are just so obsessed with finding someone who is similar. And you don't have to look very much further than the fact that the Arizona Cardinals official Twitter account today, the official Twitter account of the Arizona Cardinals, tweeted out a picture of Kliff Kingsbury. And the tweet said, Sean McVay had this to say about the newest head coach in the NFC West. And the quote from Sean McVay is, I think he's been a very good head coach. I think he's demonstrated the ability to do a lot of different things at a high level, and he's got a great offensive mind. That's a pretty bland coach. Or it's a pretty bland coach. Not a pretty bland coach. It's a pretty bland quote. But just like getting excited about the idea that Sean McVay, the golden child, mentioned the Arizona Cardinals head coach. That's not going to give the Cardinals any success. Where they're going to be successful is if they can figure out how to bring in coordinators that do for Kliff Kingsbury what the coordinators in Los Angeles are doing for Sean McVay. If the GM can be aggressive the way that the GM in LA has been aggressive to make sure that Jared Goff and Sean McVay have what they need to succeed. And some of the replies to this tweet, I mean, Jessica Johnson, please enough with the Sean McVay stuff. Mike Weinelich, wow, you guys are desperate to tie him to Sean McVay. Texas Longhorns 3113, this is just embarrassing. David Benavidez, I can't believe someone in the Cardinals organization thinks being this thirsty is a good look. Kenneth Sabi, y'all are obsessed with McVay. So anyway, I think it's weird. I think it's weird. Maybe I'm wrong. I'm wrong all the time. I was wrong to send this tweet that I was interested in this. And I was told right away, you know, it's a bad take because they beat the Chiefs and the Chargers and the Seahawks twice. And yes, they have been successful. I'm not saying that they haven't had success. I'm just saying there are facts that make me wonder about the wisdom of making Sean McVay the golden standard this early in the process. He coaches in an awful division and has a fantastic GM and quarterback. We'll find out this weekend if he earns that reputation when it counts. But of course, you know, people are interested in context, and my mentions all day long were filled with very upset Rams fans who thought that I went out of my way to attack their head coach. I think he's a great coach. I think he's a great coach. I just think it's weird that a guy that's never won a playoff game is the one that everyone is bending over back. Like the Jets and the Cardinals fought over a guy who had just got fired at a middling Big 12 school. They fought over him because of the similarity to Sean McVay, right? To me, that is strange. You can't make it not be strange. But also, I don't think it's an insult to point out the fact that Sean McVay is a good quarterback and a good GM and good assistants. You still got to win games. He still gets credit for that. But the division is bad. Right? And all those things taken into account, you know, no, I'm not saying that somebody shouldn't go out and get a good head coach. No, I'm not saying that if you're going to copy something, you should copy a bad coach. I'm just saying if we're going to copy something, maybe copy the guy that won the Super Bowl. Or don't copy at all. Do what the Eagles and Rams did and go out and make a hire that's the best fit for your organization. And maybe that's what the Cardinals did. I don't know. I'm just a guy, right? So anyway, but sticking with the topic of the Cardinals and Twitter and me making poor decisions, I was at my aunt and uncle's house today, and I'll bring them up on this podcast a lot because they're my favorite people on earth. When I was 17 years old, I lived with them for a few months, and when I visited them every summer growing up from Wyoming, grew up in Arizona, I would spend the 9 months of the school year in Arizona. As soon as school would get out, I'd fly to Wyoming to be with the other half of my family, and then as soon as school was about to start, I'd fly back. When I was 17, I spent a few months with them, and then after the end of high school, I went up there for 3 years and I lived with them. They're ex-military intelligence. They're both retired, both on disability. They love to argue. They like to discuss weird stuff. They always keep me talking about things, and man, do they get annoyed by all sorts of random things. I absolutely love spending time with them. They are the most interesting part of my life is that they are in it. So I'm over at their house today because my aunt's going through some health stuff. My uncle's going through some health stuff. So they live in Casa Grande. I live in Maricopa. I made the drive over there to spend a few hours with them today. And I'm sitting there with my aunt, and we decide that since Kliff Kingsbury's looks are a thing, that it's only fair that all the previous Arizona Cardinals head coaches get ranked according to their sex appeal. Okay, so I'm going to have to step off on this because, I mean, I know what a handsome guy looks like. I watch enough movies. They put the same type of dude in a movie over and over again. You don't have to be attracted to it to say, you know, I know what attractiveness is. When they're trying to sell you a hair gel or a cologne in a magazine, they don't put an ugly dude there. And again, whatever you're attracted to is whatever you're attracted to. What floats your boat? It's your boat. I'm not going to tell you how to drive your boat, but I am saying that I didn't feel like I could speak into this situation with the authority that it deserved. So my Aunt Lynn, she ranked the 10 previous, with excluding Kliff Kingsbury, because it seems that everyone's in agreement that this is the most handsome man that has ever walked the face of the earth. My Aunt Lynn ranked the Phoenix/Arizona Cardinals pre-Kingsbury head coaches according to their hotness and sex appeal. And it was interesting because I posted the results on Twitter, and it turned into grown men arguing over whether my aunt was right about how hot the former coaches of the Arizona Cardinals were, which absolutely made my morning. And I'm going to read a couple of those responses because I might not even be able to make it through. But this was my aunt's Phoenix/Arizona Cardinals pre-Kingsbury head coach hotness rankings. Her number one is Gene Stallings. If you know who Gene Stallings is, he was the coach when they moved here from St. Louis. He got fired pretty quick. He was replaced with Hank Coleman for a minute. And then I think Joe Bugle came in after that, if I'm not mistaken. But yeah, so Gene Stallings, who definitely looks like an in-shape Hank Hill, who looks like the handsome gas station attendant from the 1950s, just super tall, dark, and I guess handsome, according to my aunt. That was her number one. And again, excluding Kliff Kingsbury. Number two, she said Steve Wilks. She said she likes the Denzel vibe. She likes the remember the Titans vibe that Steve Wilks gives off. And here's where it got interesting. Number three, Vince Tobin. And if you've been a Cardinals fan for a while, like I have, you probably remember Vince Tobin from one of the most exciting years, which will come up later in the show, one of the most exciting years in Cardinals history, the 1998 playoff run. So this man, handsome or not, he's got a special place in my heart just for that alone. The last time he coached in the NFL, he was a special assistant for the Green Bay Packers back in 2004. He's been retired a while. He's 75 years old now. But the dude definitely has a little bit of a Paul Newman vibe to him. I mean, you could switch his head in his prime with Bill Gates' head. They have the same body, shaped like a bag of sand. But, you know, my aunt says he comes in at number three. And followed by Dave McGinnis, who is probably my favorite Cardinals coach of all time, if I'm being honest, as a longtime assistant to Jeff Fisher after he left the Cardinals. Had a great relationship with Pat Tillman, was just a really cool guy. And I remember those Sun Devil Stadium days when the Cardinals would win games they had no business winning. He'd run up in the stands and high-five people. Just a cool guy. Was a big fan of Dave McGinnis. He comes in at number four. She said number five is Joe Bugle. Joe Bugle to me looks like the, Joe Dirt's dad, from the David Spade, Joe Dirt movie. The one that lives in the trailer park and has all the little, dolls and everything. The one who left Joe Dirt, at the Grand Canyon forever, drove off without him. That's who Joe Bugle reminds me of. Number six, she had Ken Whisenhunt. And my wife decided to weigh in on that. She said Ken Whisenhunt was way too far down this list. I did not realize that that was a thing for her. She clarified later that she does not have a thing for Ken Whisenhunt, but believes that he deserves more respect on this list. I informed her that Ken Whisenhunt, to me, looks like a hairless version of the animated Disney Beast, and posted a couple of pictures of the two of them side by side on Twitter if you want to check those out. At number seven, she had Hank Coleman. At number eight, Bruce Arians, which some people found disrespectful that Mr. Kangol Hat was this far down the list. Followed by, and this was the most interesting to me, number nine, Buddy Ryan. Number 10, Dennis Green. She didn't quite tell me why she had one ranked over the other, but I think maybe Dennis Green's voice possibly came into play in these hotness rankings. And then immediately, I started getting comments from grown men. And here's a couple of them. Joe Bugle ahead of Bruce Arians. What is going on here? Here's another one from Bill Riddle, who runs and owns one of my favorite restaurants in the entire world, Valley Luna. He said Tobin and McGinnis ahead of Joe Bugle. Come on. Even Mac will admit that Joe's steely blue eyes are sexier. Like, what, how did we end up in this conversation? Let's see if I can, and it was Scott Howard 42, who, if you're a Suns fan, one of the funniest follows on Twitter by far. He is just incredible at enjoying the Suns while also being suppressed, and is one of my favorite follows. He put his own rankings in there and has Whisenhunt at number two, so him and my wife seem to agree. And then there was one in there that made me laugh really hard. The guy said, my grandfather worked for both Vince Tobin and Dave McGinnis. You have those two backwards. Like, what does that even mean? How am I supposed to take that? This guy said his grandpa worked for Vince Tobin and Dave McGinnis, so he would know firsthand who is sexier than because he trusts his grandpa. It's come up before. I don't know. I don't really know how to take that, but I laughed all morning long. So there you have it. The Aunt Lynn's Phoenix/Arizona Cardinals pre-Kingsbury head coach hotness rankings. Feel free to let me know, because as my uncle, who just watched this whole process completely aghast, decided to weigh in at the end. He said, I'm not attracted to any of these men, but it's a list, so you have my attention. And I would say that Bruce Arians needs to be higher. So as my uncle pointed out, if you're a guy and someone makes a list, even if it's a list of hottest Arizona Cardinals coaches, you're probably going to have an opinion. because you just can't help it. So if you have an opinion on this subject, feel free at Ralph Ampson on Twitter. Let's figure this out. Because if that's going to be a thing now, if we're going to have to take head coach hotness into account, we might as well get this thing figured out and figure out where Steve Wilks and Gene Stallings, Vince Tobin, where these guys rank on the list, and find out if my aunt really did do Ken Whisenhunt a disservice by having him number six. From one hot thing to another, this is the hot list.
All I need is 1,000 followers, 10,000 hours to be a platinum or gold member like it's Austin Powers. And truly lost and justified with body social towers that as I climb is still empty in the morning hours. 1,000 friends, but they don't know the struggle that's within. It's these I pen and there's a few that I'll be pressing send. The question is, can you be real with me and I with you? Can I impact the
body? So it is Friday, January 11th, 2019. There's a bunch of stuff going on, but I love to jump in the Wayback Machine and talk about some of the things that went on in Arizona sports history. I saw a couple of these on Twitter. The first item on the hot list, Eddie House. Eddie House went for 61 points for Arizona State just 19 years ago. And not today, 19 years ago today, but 19 years ago this month. I think it was January 9th. Would have been the 19-year anniversary. And I was thinking about the fact that, you know, there have been some really talented players to come through Arizona State, some fantastic scorers. I mean, Jahi Carson, Ike Diago, right now, Lou Dort has the ability to definitely get buckets whenever he wants. James Harden is on his way to becoming one of the most unique offensive weapons in NBA history. And I think above all of them, you know, we've even got Jalen House, Eddie House's son, coming up that's going to be enrolled at ASU next year. And I still feel like he comes to mind as the best offensive player to ever wear maroon and gold. And he had a fantastic NBA career. He's doing a better job as a broadcaster than I ultimately thought he would. And I didn't think that, you know, he wouldn't be able to string words together to form a sentence as a color analyst on the Pac-12 network. I was genuinely worried about Eddie House talking trash to the players on the court because he gets those competitive juices going and he just can't help himself. So I think he's definitely made a fantastic life in basketball, but I think back to that 61-point game and, you know, were we even surprised? I mean, it was astonishing at the time that someone would score that much, but I don't think anybody was surprised that he would be the one to do it. Which brings me to my next item on the hot list. Markus Howard of Marquette University dropped 53 points in an overtime game for Marquette in an overtime win yesterday. 2 days ago now when this podcast comes out. Now, Markus Howard, if you don't remember, was committed to Arizona State as a ninth grader early in his ninth grade year, held that commitment for almost 2 years. And when Herb Sendek was fired, he might have recommitted, but Stan Johnson, the assistant coach that Bobby Hurley had said he was going to try to keep on, went to Marquette. And Markus Howard left Perry, went to Finlay Prep in Nevada for 1 year, then reclassified and made the jump to college basketball a little bit early, a year early. And this is his third year at Marquette. And he has multiple 40-point games this year, multiple 40-point games. And now he's out there dropping 53 in a game. And it reminded me a little bit of Eddie House, the way that Eddie House could score. They're way different players, similar in stature. But Markus Howard is like a 5'10" jump shooter who gets, you know, 30 inches of air in his jump shot from behind the three-point line. He went 10 of 14 from three. Would have been interesting to see what ASU did with him. And it was funny, when he was in high school playing basketball here, a lot of people had him ranked behind Alex Barcelo, who was at Corona del Sol, was a guard, played with Marvin Bagley III, went to the University of Arizona. And Barcelo's had a hard time getting on the court for U of A. Meanwhile, you know, I watched a game actually where Barcelo scored 51 in high school on only like 17 shots. incredible basketball game. I for Sports 360 AZ, I built up a shot chart. I wrote about how it was the most impressive 50-plus point high school game I'd ever seen. And in that game, Corona had beat Perry, and Markus Howard was on the court, scored 48 of his own, got overshadowed. But here he is in college, and he is getting it done. And there's got to be some level of regret in there for Arizona State fans, but as somebody who followed him since eighth grade, I mean, I'm happy for the kid. He's out there just ruining people's records. I'm sure he's got more career points than Jimmy Butler. Got to be closing in on Dwayne Wade. It'll be interesting to see if he stays for his senior year. Because he's averaging something like 25, 26 points a game as a junior. Is this a guy that could average 30 as a senior? It'd be pretty cool to see. But yeah, the Eddie House thing just definitely reminded me of Markus Howard definitely reminded me of Eddie House. And then another great moment in Arizona sports history. This is the day, I believe, it might have even been the same day or the day after, Eddie House scored 61 points. This is the day that the Suns traded Robert Horry for throwing a towel in Danny Ainge's face. They got Cedric Ceballos back from Los Angeles, and Robert Horry went on to just steal rings the way that he always did. I think he ended up with like 7 or 8 championships, and a few of those are thanks to the fact that, well, first, that the Suns couldn't beat the Rockets when Jordan was retired, and second, because the Suns gave Robert Horry Big Shot Bob over to the Lakers. And we won't even talk about what he did to the Suns when he was with the Spurs. I hate that guy so much. It is hard for me to understand why anybody who's an Arizona sports fan wouldn't have Robert Horry as enemy number one. Because, yeah, John Paxson killed you the one time. Robert Horry did it over and over and over again. And then when he wore your jersey, he threw a towel in the coach's face. I do not like Robert Horry. I went to the wedding of a friend a year and a half ago now, and I almost didn't go when I found out the guy she was marrying was a huge Robert Horry fan just because of the championships. Because he was a fan of the end result, a fan of just success. I hadn't met the guy yet. She's a long, long, long time friend. My introduction to the dude that she's marrying is that he's a Robert Horry fan. Oh, that was hard to get over. But we got over it. He's a good dude. He's actually the person whose voice you hear on the music leading into the hot list every single day. His name's Warren Christian. He's a talented musician, and I won't hold it against him that he likes the biggest villain in Arizona sports history, in my opinion. Next up on the hot list, Chip Lindsey versus Billy Napier. That is wild to me. Chip Lindsey, who'd have thought that he wouldn't stick around very long in any given place? If you remember, Chip Lindsey came over from he came over to Arizona State to be the offensive coordinator under Todd Graham. And in the weird, incestuous Auburn-Arizona State relationship in which Gus Malzahn would borrow coaches from Todd Graham as a weird repayment for the fact that Todd Graham gave Gus Malzahn a job as a coordinator when he was down and out. You know, Gus Malzahn keeps stealing guys from his friend, and he definitely stole Chip Lindsey, which resulted in Billy Napier coming over from Alabama to Arizona State to be the offensive coordinator, and then Billy Napier left to be the head coach at Louisiana Lafayette. Well, Chip Lindsey did the 2 years of being an offensive coordinator at Auburn. He was basically told it's time to go, and he ended up taking the job at Kansas and the Kansas rebuild that's going to happen over there under Les Miles as offensive coordinator. And as he has done previously, he did not stick around long. He took the head coaching job at Troy, which means Chip Lindsey, who was never on Arizona State staff at the same time as Billy Napier. Billy Napier replaced Chip Lindsey. It means that Chip Lindsey and Billy Napier are probably going to go head-to-head in conference next year as head coaches of Troy and Louisiana Lafayette. And all of a sudden, I'm interested in a stupid football game that's taking place 2,000 miles away with maybe one or two players that I know football is a crazy, crazy business. So I thought that was kind of interesting. I'm looking forward to when the schedule comes out. I hope that they're on each other's schedule. I will make time to watch that game. Not sure who I'll be rooting for in that instance. Definitely want both of those guys to have success. They made the best business decision for themselves in that process. But I do just think it's coaching is a very, very interesting business. Speaking of coaches, and to bring up Kliff Kingsbury again, a video is circulating on the internet in which Kliff Kingsbury describes Kyler Murray as someone that he would use the number one pick on if he had the number one pick in the NFL draft. Well, guess what? Kliff Kingsbury has the number one pick in the NFL draft, but obviously the Cardinals already have a quarterback. So Adam Schefter, a couple other people on Twitter are floating this idea that like maybe Kliff Kingsbury is like Chip Kelly, where Chip Kelly was willing to risk it all and trade everything away in order to have Marcus Mariota at the NFL level. And that maybe the reason that Chip Kelly didn't succeed at the NFL level is because he never got his hands on Marcus Mariota, and Marcus Mariota went to the Titans. It's not like that. It was funny to see John Gambadoro and other people, Scott Bordeaux, just say, like, what are you guys freaking out about? This is never going to happen. I brought it up on yesterday's thing that I thought it was a crafty of Kliff Kingsbury to go back in time and plant this seed so that the number one pick would be worth more. But it's just funny to watch. It keeps growing and growing because national pundits, maybe it's Kyler Murray's agent that's just floating the idea that the Cardinals would be interested in picking him at number one and ignoring the fact that they just took Josh Rosen in the last draft. But I am super entertained by this, and I hope it continues to spiral out of control because, I need some stuff to laugh at. Last up on the hot list, we're going to travel down to Tucson and talk some U of A football. I thought that it was fascinating that P.J. Johnson, defensive lineman P.J. Johnson, declared for the NFL draft. I mean, he's got two kids. Now, University of Arizona, we're used to one-and-dones, right? But on the basketball court, we're not used to seeing a guy come in, take a football program by storm, and then move on. But he's already got two kids, and he probably got a favorable grade from scouts. All I know is he had a good year. 31 tackles for a D tackle, 8.5 tackles for a loss in just 10 games. He was good at City College of San Francisco. He was out there with a couple of different ASU players. And here he's 6'4", 335, and he's declared for the NFL draft. And now the interior for Arizona's defensive line has moved on because Derek Bolas is a graduating senior as well. So I thought it was interesting. I wanted to note that P.J. Johnson is moving on to the NFL draft after 1 year there, because we see one-and-dones at University of Arizona all the time on the basketball court. DeAndre Ayton, obviously. But we don't often see something like that happen in football. I remember it happened with Garrett Bolas, who was somebody that Arizona State was recruiting heavily. They even had Chris Thompson, Arizona State's offensive line coach at the time, went to this guy's wedding. He was a Snow College, junior college offensive lineman, was already married. He ended up deciding to stay home at Utah, and after 1 year was a first-round pick of the Denver Broncos. So it'll be interesting to see if P.J. Johnson ends up, getting some of that early round money so that he can take care of his family. I wish nothing but the best for him. 6'4", 335. My goodness. He literally leaves a giant hole on Arizona's defensive line. And that is the end of the ArizonaSportsCast.com Daily Fix Hot List. Now for the final topic of the day. So I know it was kind of a silly segment earlier on when we brought up Vince Tobin on my aunt's sex appeal list of Arizona Cardinals coaches pre-Kliff Kingsbury. But I'm glad Vince Tobin's name came up today because it reminded me that I want to talk about one of the players that played for him, that I was an enormous fan of in his time at Arizona, who's unfortunately no longer with us, and that's Kwamie Lassiter. There's not very many guys anymore after I started reporting on sports, you know, that I remained a fan of. I've come into contact with a lot of the people that I used to root for, you know, in professional sports prior to ever entering this industry, you know, whether that be Kurt Warner as offensive coordinator of a high school football team that I have to cover, or people who, you know, I might have used to root for that are now members of the media that I've had to work with. On occasion, I know that, you know, Ryan Keeley was somebody who, when I was in high school, loved rooting for that guy when he was at ASU, and he was at St. Mary's before that. And, you know, he's a guy who, you know, married somebody who I went to high school with and has since become a little bit of a friend and somebody, you know, who has been there for my family when, you know, when we've needed stuff. And so, you know, you get to know some of these people that you rooted for, and some of that luster goes away, some of that the starstruck nature. But Kwamie Lassiter is somebody who I actually had the opportunity to encounter a couple of times. In that, you know, I think he had a son and a nephew on Hamilton's football team, and I covered Hamilton High School, and I still like would revert to that childlike state of just, you know, man, this guy was awesome. That's Kwamie. Like, I'd see Kwamie Lassiter at Hamilton High School and say, that's Kwamie Lassiter. And the reason for that is he is responsible for what is probably my favorite childhood sports memory. And he's directly responsible for maybe my second favorite childhood sports memory. While playing for Vince Tobin in 1998, the Arizona Cardinals had stockpiled a team that just was chock full of talent on the defensive line, at defensive back, which he played, Jake Plummer, Larry Centers, Frank Sanders is my all-time favorite player, next to maybe Anquan Boldin. And in the final regular season game of 1998, the Arizona Cardinals basically like needed to win to go to the playoffs. They had never been to the playoffs in the state of Arizona. And so I was this fan of this team that was just perennially terrible, right? And so this was the most pressure ever as a kid of anyone that I had ever rooted for going into any game. They had to win. And Kwamie Lassiter picked off 4 passes in that game. It's completely insane for somebody to get 2 interceptions in a game. I mean, professional quarterbacks don't make very many mistakes. For a guy to get 3, I mean, that's something that you remember forever if that's a team that you're a fan of. 4 interceptions in a game, though, to clinch a playoff spot? Man, instant hero status. Kwamie Lassiter, instant hero in my mind as a kid. And I think at the time I was maybe 14 years old, and just instantly, I mean, I loved that whole secondary and a lot of the guys that he played alongside in his time in Arizona. I was a huge fan of David Barrett. Obviously, we know what Pat Tillman means to people. Aeneas Williams might be the greatest Cardinal to ever suit up. And Kwamie Lassiter is the one who stood out that day, and he's the one who gave Aeneas Williams the opportunity to lock down Michael Irvin of the hated Dallas Cowboys in the opening round of the playoffs, so that I could experience for the very first time my team growing up winning a playoff game. They would not have gotten there. They wouldn't have gotten to that point. I wouldn't have that memory of Frank Sanders tipping a pass to himself for a huge gain in that 1998 playoff game. I wouldn't have the memory of Mario Bates scoring 3 touchdowns, but the Cardinals losing by like 1,000 points to the Minnesota Vikings that next week either. But I wouldn't have had the memory of the Arizona Cardinals taking down the Dallas Cowboys in the playoffs. Who would have thought? And that was all thanks to Kwamie Lassiter. I never, ever forgot about that. And, I mean, that was a wild season for him. He had 4 interceptions going into that game. He ends up getting 4 more just at the end. And then, you know, and then everyone knows who he is. He's kind of a big star. And in 1999, the guy has over 100 tackles. And then in 2001, he has over 100 tackles and he picks off 9 passes. I mean, just incredible athlete, raised a good kid, a great nephew, enjoyed covering his kids when they were here. They had all moved to Kansas, and I think one of his, I don't know, I'm sure if it's his nephew or his son, is actually on University of Kansas's roster just like he was, but could never really bring myself to see him as like just another adult equal to me. I'm definitely sad that he passed, I don't know what else there is to say. That's somebody who I grew up rooting for, and it's hard to believe that he's gone, and you know that he was on that same team with Pat Tillman, and the reason that Pat Tillman had to wear 40 instead of 42 was that Kwamie Lassiter was out there in that number 42. And so to end this daily fix, ArizonaSportsCast.com, we'll just say rest in peace, 42. It's reeling from the feeling in my mind, but I feel it in the physical. Why's the sunlight hiding?